incredible beauty of this temple. And I have it to myself, I haven't seen another person.
I've never really been a tourist here in my life. But the international restaurant scene has been pretty much wiped out. So pleased we took a little detour. So right now I am suffering from a pretty severe dose of traveler's whiplash. Over the last 4 weeks I've been across too many time zones, too many climate zones, too many cultures, too many languages, but I am not complaining. Borders have reopened and travel has resumed for nearly a year now. And I've spent most of that year on the road making up for lost travel time. I've come away feeling more aware than ever of the privilege it is to travel. But I've also come away with another awareness. And that is that travel has changed forever. In this video, we're going to look at how the world of travel has changed, and we're also going to think about how the cultural traveler can take steps to deal with a new world of travel. It's a big story, so welcome to part one, and hit subscribe so you don't miss part two. Back in February 2020, I shot a little video here just at the beginning of the pandemic, and I talked about risk. Travel has always involved risk, and throughout my lifetime, the risks of travelling have actually been decreasing. Aircraft are safer than ever, political risks have been in decline, you've had a better hope of finding a decent hospital, no matter where you are in the world. For decades, a globalised world has made travel safer and easier. But is the era of ever safer, ever easier travel coming to an end? You could easily make the argument that the reductions in the risks of international travel that have taken place over the last three or four decades are now being eroded by a new set of risks. The risk that you'll be exposed to extreme weather during travels is greater now than at any time in modern history. In Sydney, the wettest year on record was confirmed months before the year's end. Elsewhere in Australia, we have witnessed once in 100 or once in 1,000 year flooding. From Asia to Europe, North America and Africa, extreme heat, storms and drought have also broken records. The people who've been warning us of this stuff for decades also predict that this is just the beginning. The geopolitical situation seems to be more fractious, more complicated at the moment than it's been at any time in my lifetime. How these uncertain geopolitical times will impact travel is anyone's guess. But in a globalized world, changed geopolitical risks mean changed travel risks. And the risk of another pandemic and the impact that will have on travel. We don't think about it so much now, but quite a lot of people, quite a lot of Australians, for example, found themselves stuck in pretty difficult situations in foreign countries when borders closed in 2020. So while travel has become less risky in so many ways over the last three or four decades, new risks are emerging that might offset those gains. You know, it's funny, I think about my first international travels nearly 40 years ago, and some of the standout things to consider that have changed since then are that, of course, there were no mobile phones. Travel really meant being isolated, particularly traveling in the developing world. My first trips to Vietnam, you disappear off the map for the whole time you're away. And you'd only sort of confirm that you were living and breathing. Either if you were away long enough, you might send a postcard or a letter. And very occasionally, you might make a phone call. But they were horrendously expensive. I really do miss that idea of complete isolation when you travel. That was a very special thing to experience. And of course, it wasn't isolation from people, it was isolation from the familiar and friends and family. For me, that was an invaluable learning experience, and it helped me appreciate the rewards of solo travel. You had to work out a lot of stuff for yourself. You might have a Lonely Planet or a rough guide in your backpack. And you'd seek out the advice of other travellers. But there was no internet, no Google Maps, no Instagram. You were also far more dependent on working things out with the locals, especially in remote places.
Hello, hello.
Now when you travel, most interactions with locals are optional rather than a necessity. So how do we respond to this travel environment of changed risk? For me, you go back to where we started, which is that travel has always been risky. And to put it in perspective, have a think about the kinds of risks people were taking 50 years ago, 100 years ago, when they traveled. It might also be worth considering some of the risks you've taken yourself as a traveler over the years. And remember that the rewards of travel outweigh those risks. There is a lot more than risk to think about as we consider how travel has changed. In part two in this series, we'll take a look at how a handful of enormous tech companies shape the way we travel and dominate the tourism economy. Join me for that. And if you'd like to travel some more with Rusty Compass, you can subscribe to this channel and you can also check us out over at rustycompass.com. If you'd like to take a walk of history and heritage with us in Sydney or Saigon, head over to oldcompasstravel.com. Thank you very much for joining me, and we will talk again very soon. Cheers.